Not a very long stream, but we do have a lot of movie clips. Yeah, milk smoke clouds, yes. Milk to, like, we get from the cow, not the almond milk stuff. No, we're going full blown like got milk. We're going full blown got milk style. This is dairy, but don't worry everyone, it's lactose safe. but yes, so without any further ado. But yeah, like I said, this subject was as a suggestion from the Discord, so if there's any subject that you're interested in having as a theme for one of our streams, please feel free to share it with us in the suggestions channel. But yeah, so to get us started, let's see. What's those figures and stuff on my desk? Oh, good question. These are Legos. These are all Legos. Right here we have Luke Skywalker, for instance. An old classic version. And these are just little creatures that I make out of Legos. They just kind of keep me entertained and happy. I have more. There's tons here. And some of them were gifts from my lovely Quildren, getting me lovely little Lego figurines to have. This is a little nutcracker we have going on here. But yeah. They help keep me company. They remind me of all of you. That's all I can say. There's not much space to work, but I don't mind. There's room for everyone in the land of the holy quail. Yes, let's see. Where to start? Okay. Let's see. Okay, so for our intro, the concept, milk. God milk, anybody. So the thing about milk, it's so interesting in the way how it's been used in terms of visual representation. Like, we can see it, for instance, like right here. Like, we can see the, like, Romulus and Phoebus, the founders of Rome, like when there were orphaned infants suckling on, you know, the titties of a cow. not of a cow, sorry, of a wolf. So, like, there's mythology that goes back to milk. Milk that can be even represented as simply as in a still life, like this one by Cezanne. Even in Hindu culture, right here, we have the creation of the goddess, when the way how it was made is that the forces of good and evil churned the ocean into milk, and from that they were able to spur the, you know, her holiness, so to speak. In this case, actually, milk is even used as a medium, as an art medium, a material in of itself. Has anyone tried putting, like, food dye in milk? Well, that's what you can get, for instance. So, it's really versatile in the way milk is represented and used. Another one is, as you saw an image here up earlier, in ancient Egypt. In ancient Egypt, milk, like, we saw a lot of references in the hieroglyphs in regards to milk, because milk was considered to be a delicacy. You know what I mean? It was only reserved for the rich, right? I mean, granted, it takes a long time to probably milk a cow to get a glass of milk. I don't know. I didn't live on a farm. Whoever has tried, please let me know. I'd like to know. but yes, so the classic interpretation and the first symbols that come to mind when we use milk is a representation of innocence, right? Because it goes back to the time of birth, to the time of infancy, return to the womb, return to motherhood. And so that is the classic way in which milk is represented in art, or milk just as a form of iconography, so to speak. Like you can see in this painting right here. But you know, that's like, since that's the classic, most overused interpretation, I wanted to try to present to all of you for this stream the more unconventional ways in which milk can be interpreted. With me so far, everyone? Like, this is one of my favorite pieces. This one is by Marc Chagall. He was an expressionist, really great for his time, and like the title implies, it's called The Spoonful of Milk. And at first it doesn't seem like much, but the colors alone just tell so much emotion. And the idea of, you know, just being able only to afford a spoonful of milk in order to survive after a whole day's worth of work, it is extremely emotionally charged. It is very, you know, it tells a whole story in just one moment in time, right? You start to ask yourself more questions. Okay, well, like, you know, is this a couple? Is this like a mother and son, maybe? Like, what is he reading? What, like, where are they living? It is like, it adds all these different layers for us to dig deep into. But at the same time, as much as there's so many layers for us to analyze, there is this barrenness of only being able to afford a spoonful of milk, a spoonful of milk, which is, I don't know, very heartwarming and very sad and endearing all at the same time. Being spoon-fed a spoonful of milk, it's just, it gets me. But that's like one of the most iconographic works in regards to how they use milk. But let me see, let me make sure. See, do I have, okay. But now to get into, like, continuing with this idea of, like, of milk and barrenness, and also just, like, you know, the bitterness of life, so to speak. We are going to start off strong, everyone, with Star Wars. Let's see if you can guess what scene this is, and, like, this is from. So even though that was such a small moment in the film, it tells an exceedingly amount about our character right here. Like the milk itself, that is, like, this green milk, I should say. We're gonna consider this green milk a form of normal milk, okay, for the sake of, like, understanding this stream. It's kind of grotesque, and it looks very bitter. The milk is just kind of putrid and gross, and even the way that he drinks it. And that's telling about Luke Skywalker, our character, that over the years, he has just been living in so much isolation, so much desolateness, that he is no longer the man that he used to be. He's now become this old, bitter, putrid, almost putrid person inside and out. But so that's an interesting way in which they used milk as a prop for that film, at least green milk to be specific. And I just love her expression, just looking, and I'm like, I'm not sure if I like what I'm seeing here. Very awkward, very telling. But another film that uses, like, uses milk in a very similar trope is in the movie The Great Lebowski.
Because what's a hero? But sometimes there's a man, and I'm talking about the dude here. Sometimes there's a man, he's the man for his time and place. He fits right in there. And that's the dude in Los Angeles. And even if he's a lazy man, and the dude was most certainly that, quite possibly the laziest in Los Angeles County, which would place him high in a running for laziest worldwide. But sometimes there's a man. Sometimes there's a man. Ah. lost my train of thought here. But, hell. I done introduced him enough.
With them all for collective action. This will not stand. This will not stand, this aggression against Kuwait.
Here on the range I belong, drifting along with the tumbling, tumbleweed.
Okay, so there's a lot to unpack in this opening scene alone. So very much like the Luke Skywalker character, the one from The Great Lebowski, the protagonist is also down on his luck. He, like, isn't in any, like, that you can tell by the way he's dressed. Like, he is not in no form any way prestigious. He is down on his luck. Like, he's hit rock bottom, basically. And but the whole premise of the film is he gets confused for being a billionaire. Like a billionaire that looks just like him. And so if you look at the opening scene very closely, he's actually not reaching for milk. He actually accidentally reached for half and half. And so there's this theory that it's actually supposed to be a reference to him. Like, this half and half is actually a reference to him and his, like, and his character in the film, because he's confused for being, like, you know, this billionaire person. Like, but, like, no, is he billionaire? Is he poor? Like, he has, like, he's half and half, basically. And he's not whole. Like, you get what I did there? He's not whole, like, whole milk. But that's just a little, you know, holy quail humor for you. But yeah, so that's, like, I just love those little details in films. When the director just puts those little elements, and then when you go back to see them, oh, gets me every time. But going to another classic film here that I'm sure everyone has seen, and everyone is going to recognize this scene. But I want to use this as a moment to go back to more of an earlier stage in the juvenile stage of Milk. Let's see. Oh, it's a hilarious movie. It is, yes. Oh, Maxilum, welcome to the stream. Good to see you, my friends. You're just in time for a little bit of Home Alone. Right off the bat.
Kevin, get upstairs right now.
Why?
Kevin, you're such a disease.
Shut up.
Kevin, upstairs.
Say goodnight, Kevin.
Goodnight, Kevin.
Exactly, Maxilum. Kevin! But yeah, what I couldn't get a clip that was from earlier, like, just like a few seconds earlier in that scene. Kevin's mother actually tells everyone on the table, "I hope you all like milk, because that's what we're having, because we need to finish it, because I don't want it to go bad." So the idea was that there was all this milk on the table, glasses upon glasses, because they were trying to get rid of the milk. But okay, so yeah, ultimately, like, in the fight with his cousin, Kevin, like, ends up spilling all the milk. Haha, no crying over spilled milk, right? Not in this case. But nevertheless, everyone was very furious with him. So in this case, the reference of spilled milk is a representation of how everyone felt towards Kevin. Like, they put their anger on towards him instead of, like, you see what I'm doing there? So I thought that was a really smart reference. But at the end of the day, if you think about it, if the mother was really trying to get rid of the milk and was forcing everyone to drink the milk, well, okay, yeah, like, and in reality, there's nothing to cry about. You weren't trying to save the milk, you were trying to get rid of it. But yet, nevertheless, everyone was furious with him. You know, it kind of shows, like, the double standard of the family in that sense. So yeah, no, like, again, milk strikes again. But I think one of my favorite scenes that uses milk as a punchline is this one. Napoleon Dynamite, ladies and gentlemen.
I see you're drinking 1%. Is that because you think you're fat? Because you're not. You could be drinking whole if you wanted to. Well, I have all your equipment in my locker. You should probably come get it because I can't fit my nunchucks in there anymore.
Where's your locker?
Yeah, so the Sean milk is terrible. Don't let Giga Datum catch you saying that. But yeah, everyone, go give LaShawn a follow. He started streaming. I haven't been able to catch you, Sean, but I need to watch his stream sometime. Ugh, like, it's gotta happen. So happy you started it. Well done. Yeah, no, everyone, go give LaShawn a follow, all right? He was one of the first ones here on the stream with me, so I want, like, we have to pass it forward, right, everybody? Oh gosh, yes, Maxwell, it was such a great pickup line, right? Like, using something just as simple as milk to create the most awkward pickup line ever, but she liked it, it worked, right? And I think that is one of the most successful ways and direct, obvious ways in which milk has been used as a prop in a film and a script. Like you don't want to watch, I don't want to watch. No, of course I do. I've just been super busy. As you can tell by my Instagram stories, I've just been super busy, Sean. But yeah, no, it's on my bucket list. I need to catch you. I need to catch you streaming one day. Now I'm trying to think of a milk film. Haha, well, Maxim, there's lots to come. Hopefully, if you come up with any, like, hopefully I'm able to catch it in this stream. Hopefully we're able to catch it. This next film is just a very small snippet because I could only get this amount for the copyright that it is, so I apologize for that, but it gets the point across. Again, referencing this element of youth and juvenilism. This is from the movie Rebel Without a Cause, and this is supposedly a very crucial turning point in the character's development. So he goes to the fridge and drinks straight from the bottle of milk because it's supposed to be his way of trying to find love through nourishment. Like, he's looking for this affection. He's looking for just unconditional love, so to speak. And that is a very telling point in the film. Let's see. I have to go. I just wanted to stop by and say hi. Oh, LaShawn, thank you for stopping by to say hi. I always get excited when you come in. I had an eventful stream today. It wasn't supposed to happen, but it was a funny with drama. Ooh, it had drama. Is there a VOD for me to watch, Sean? There better be a VOD. You can't tell me there was drama and not let me watch it. Okay. Oh, smoke clouds. I've got nipples. Greg, can you milk the parents? Meet the parents. Oh, I should have thought about that one. That's a good one, Smoke Clouds. Nice. Oh, well done. VOD is only on Kick. I don't publish on Twitch. Oh, only on Kick. Okay. Good to know, though. Good to know. I'll be sure to look into it, Sean. Drinking never solves any problems. It only makes them worse. True. True malice. It does. It definitely does. But, like, even if it's milk, like in that scene, like, do you think it only makes the problems worse if it's milk? Well, maybe if you're lactose intolerant, maybe that's the case, that'll make it worse. It's maybe an hour or so when I start watching a video by someone who is evil. Oh, really? You got me intrigued now, Sean. Got me super intrigued. Well, hey, you go do your thing, my friend, and we'll report back to compare drama gossip. Not that I do that, but oh well. Let's see. Yeah, so very similar to the film Rebel Without a Cause, we also have this small snippet from the film Catch Me If You Can.
Have a seat.
Thank you.
Would you like a drink after takeoff?
Milk.
80 knots.
Check.
V1, rotate. V2, positive range.
Gear up.
Granted, it is such a tiny moment in the film, so tiny, but this is right when the character, like, decides to, you know, like, do his con artist magic for the first time to catch a plane, which is very interesting. And when the flight attendant asks him, "What do you want to drink?" and he asks, and he stutters, asking for milk, it's a telling sign for us to think, okay, this person started out very young, you know, like they feel almost, at least in that scene, he feels for the first time like, gosh, like I'm really a fraud sitting here. I'm actually a child. Like I shouldn't be, like, you know, like in this spot, in this seat. But so he asks for milk as a way to almost comfort himself, to offer himself like a grounding moment of like, okay, everything's gonna work out, everything's gonna be okay. Because, you know, whenever we're in high stressful situations, who do we look towards? We look towards our mothers, right? At least I do. I look to Mama Quail for every rhyme and reason. But yeah, we look to our mothers, and the most telling symbol, the most universal symbol in regards to a mother is milk. So there you go. I'll DM you the link on the Discord. Oh yes, do that, Sean. I'd like that. Please do. Please do indeed. Yeah, so continuing with this idea of mother's milk, this is, okay, I'm trying to keep a straight face. I tried to keep a straight face with this one. This piece is a representation of the miraculous lactation of Saint Bernard. Now, is this the most successful examples of this scene? I'll leave that for all of you to decide, but it's definitely humorous. Essentially, it tells the story of Saint Bernard, and there's debate as to whether he was awake or asleep at the time, but the Madonna appeared to him in a vision, and it says that she made her breast milk trickle on his lips. Now, that is not trickling, as far as I know. That is like direct aim. That is Top Gun aiming style that we have going on in this depiction. But this is a theme that reoccurs a lot in this iconographic artwork in regards to milk. Like, we see a lot of representations of Saint Bernard and different ways in which the Madonna is projectiling milk at him. I don't know how else to describe it. But at least next time you see an image like this in a church, you know what's it about. Let's see. But yeah, I wish I could have gotten a video of this piece. Who here is familiar with Maria Abramović? We've talked about her in previous streams. She is a fantastic, fantastic performance artist. She did the work The Artist Is In, if you're familiar with that. But I really love this piece. It's one of her most successful pieces, but surprisingly not that many people know about it. And so, as you see, does anyone want to guess which setting she is in? What is this domain that she is standing in? Because when it comes to performance art, you have to think of all the variables. You don't have to just think about what you are doing physically in the performance. You also have to think, What are you wearing? What materials are you using? What is the place? What is the place that she's in? Let's see. So I found like this beautiful description of like of the work itself. If so, bear with me, everyone, because it's just it was just so beautifully written. Let's see. Hand of Malice, a kitchen. Yes, yes, she is in a kitchen. Very well done. Malice reading the titles. Ugh, best student of the night. but yes, so the piece is called Carrying the Milk. And it was filmed in an abandoned kitchen of the like in Spain. It was filmed in an abandoned kitchen in Spain, which was originally built to be an orphanage. In this self-portrait as a foster mother, the artist, austere and dressed in black, is a monastic setting of this time-ravaged kitchen, religiously, holds a container of milk, despite an apparent stillness and a mind inhabited by action. The artist trembles, gradually spilling the milk liquid on her long black dress. The milk references the initial purpose of the place, and the kitchen resembles that of her pious grandmother, where family life took place. With the addition of mystical reference, the performance of the kitchen series are inspired by the life of Saint Teresa of Avila. And her contemplative nature, Maria Abramović continues to explore the precarious balance between the body and spirit, considering her work as a form of spiritual purification. Ain't that just lovely? Ain't that just lovely? Yeah, no, so you're right, Malice. It is indeed a kitchen, but it's a kitchen of an orphanage. And so the concept of being in this barren, abandoned kitchen and holding a bowl of milk to the absolute brim. That's why I wish I had the video, because you can see how like she's just like the slightest bit of movement, the milk spills, and it makes you kind of gives you a bit of anxiety. It gives you this like, you know, like kind of like a way a mother holds a child very carefully, very, you know, like precariously, and she's trying not to let this milk spill. And indeed, a very religious way in which she is depicted, like with the long garb and the hands outstretched almost in prayer, you know. But no, I love this piece, and it was very personal to her, as you could tell by the description. But now continuing with a less serious note in regards to religion. Who can guess this movie?
If this cookie beats Gladys's, it will prove once and for all that the Kowalskis have much more free time. And the cookie is 10 feet 4 inches. We have a new record! Cue the cheesy inspirational music! What are we really looking at here? Is it just a big cookie? Or does this cookie represent the pride of Buffalo? Its dedicated and hardworking citizens, the key ingredient, with a few nuts thrown in, and finally, the love of our families, which provides the warm, chewy center, making our beloved Buffalo the sweetest place to live. And that's the way the cookie crumbles. I'm Bruce Nolan, Eyewitness News. And cut it. If this cookie.
All right, so I don't think I need to explain the movie Bruce Almighty. I think we're all very familiar with the premise of how he goes on to absorb the powers of God throughout the film. And so I thought it was really interesting that they made this scene part of the opening credits, because as he's running across, pouring this giant, like, a pitcher of milk, splashing all the children and everything, and it's so jovial and so bountiful. That's the idea. It's so bountiful that I think it's a reference to how, you know, throughout, like, towards the end of the movie, he's again going to be giving back so much. He's going to, it's like God trying to, you know, like, bestow upon miracles, bestow upon, nurture and nourishment and wealth, all that wrapped in together. And since he is the one pouring all the milk, it goes on, it's kind of a metaphor for how he's going to go on to become God throughout the rest of the film. Pretty interesting, no? You'll never think of Bruce Almighty the same way again. But then again, there are more sinister ways in which, like, milk and godliness are connected. So, who wouldn't want to take a bath of milk? I mean, it's filled with like 7 essential nutrients, right? Ooh, the Statue of Liberty, that's a good one. I like that. Yeah, the Statue of Liberty type, I like it. yeah, especially with the crown going on, kind of also very much a mummy-like, the way that she's coming out. But yeah, no, it's like, I like that. I always really enjoyed that scene. I remember when I saw it in theaters for the first time and I was fascinated by it. I thought it was the best use of CGI I'd ever seen at the time. And in this case, it's really nice because it kind of references a little bit of what we saw in in Hindu religion, how milk is also a direct link to immortality and to youthfulness. Milk doesn't stick to you like that, though. That was like paint. I know, right, Malice? That was like paint. I mean, unless that is like some form of whole milk that we haven't yet discovered. I mean, maybe that came from a very, very, I don't know, very pregnant cow, maybe? I don't know. But yeah, like, but at least it's described. I looked it up in the film, and they do describe it to be milk. I don't think it works that way. It definitely doesn't work that way. It makes me want to take a bath of milk, yes. Even though I know I won't come out that way. Sticky milk, exactly, sticky milk. That is what you get when you get whole milk and you put powder milk together and you churn it for days. But yes, Malice, I agree with you. But yeah, no, in the movie they did directly say that it was milk, but I don't know. I don't need to take a bath of milk to know that that's not the way normal milk works. let's see. Okay, so for this next one, for this next movie that we have coming up, it's a bit of a longer scene, but it's, I don't know, it's a classic. No Country for Old Men. Let's see.
Yes, sir?
I'm looking for Llewellyn Moss.
Did you go up to his trailer? Yes, I did.
Well, I'd say he's at work. Do you want to leave a message?
Where does he work?
I can't say.
I agree, Maxillum.
Where does he work?
Sir, I ain't at liberty to give out no information about our residence.
Where does he work?
Did you not hear me? We can't give out no information.
Sheriff's Department.
Look at that log.
You going in?
Gun out and up.
What about yours?
I'm hiding behind you.
Sheriff's Department.
I believe they done laid a shot.
I believe you're right.
That from the lock?
Probably must be.
So when was he here, Sheriff?
I don't know. No. Now that's aggravating.
Sheriff?
I'm still sweating.
Oh, Sheriff! We just missed him! We gotta circulate this on radio.
All right. Well, what do we circulate?
Looking for a man who has recently drunk milk?
Ah, Sheriff, that's aggravating.
I'm ahead of you there.
You think this boy Moss has got any notion of the sorts of sons of bitches that are hunting him?
I don't know. He ought to. He's seen the same things I've seen, and it certainly made an impression on me.
Like, Maxillum, no, I have not seen Beautiful. No, I haven't. I'll have to look that up. Let's see. Smash Grab. Let's see. Great movie. Highly recommend Cormac McCarthy and the author of book. Ooh, The Blood Meridian. Especially good. I thank you. I love it when you all give me movie and book recommendations. It's after a stream, I always have a lot of homework to do. Like you said, Maxillum said, one of the greatest actors of our time was in that scene, and I agree. And I really enjoy this scene because I haven't seen another segment in a movie where both the sides of good and evil drink from the same bottle. Because usually in films they separate. Either good is seen drinking the milk or the side of bad is seen drinking the milk. There's always this division between the two, but this is one very rare case where we see it both come together, and it's very telling sign because it's sort of this detail of, you know, we were all at one point children, we were all born from a womb, we were all human, so to speak, and but somewhere along the way, We deviate from that path, but nevertheless, we always have this longing to return to something that was our own, that was our innocence, that was our little piece of home, so to speak. It is like the story of Da Vinci's model for the Last Supper. Oh, really? I didn't know that. Yes. Are you talking about the story of how Da Vinci the model that Da Vinci used for Jesus? Are you familiar with that story, Silver Paulus? Is that the one you're talking about? Like our shared mammarian origins, exactly, yes. I think what Silver Paulus is talking about, which I'm so glad you brought it up, Silver Paulus, that's such a good analysis. So I think the story Silver Paulus is talking about is like, okay, I love this story because, okay, we're going to put on music because I love this story. So the story goes, Da Vinci, back when he was painting The Last Supper, he painted each of the disciples one at a time. The very first person that he asked to model for him was the figure in the center that was Jesus. And, you know, he got the most perfect man with long hair, like chiseled features. He was perfect. And so, and throughout the year, Da Vinci slowly started gathering models, you know, like for the different apostles one at a time. And he kept finding the most perfect, the most perfect one for each of them. Until the very last one he had to do was Judas. And he searched and searched, and nowhere could he find a Judas. He looked everywhere. He looked all over the place, but no, he wasn't finding the person that he thought looked like Judas. And until one day, Da Vinci is walking the streets, and he comes across this man. He had sunken eyes, like he was very frail, very weak looking. He looked very sickly. Like, he had very little hair. Like, he looked like the most sorrowful, miserable man, most down on his luck. And Da Vinci sees him, and he's like, that's my Judas! I have to have him! So he rushes over and says, please, will you come to my studio? Will you model for me? And the man says, okay, yes, I'll model for you. And shortly into the session, as Da Vinci is painting the study for, like, that he'll then later take back to paint on the mural for The Last Supper, the man starts crying. He just starts bawling crying in the middle of the session. And Da Vinci asks him, why are you crying? Have I done something to offend you? Are you all right? Can I get you something? What have I done? And the man says, you really don't recognize me, do you? You really don't recognize me. That man that Da Vinci was painting was the same man that modeled for him as Jesus. So like Silver Polish said, that story is a representation how there is a good and evil in us all. In each and every one of us, there is a Jesus and there is a Judas. Right? Yeah, no, so, and yeah, Silver Polish, that was an excellent analysis into this film. Like, it definitely lends into that. It's like, there's good and evil in all of us, and it just depends on which direction we choose to go, or which direction life forces us to take. But yeah, no, that's one of my favorite stories in art history. But returning back to the scene of the crime of... like seeing the crime, pun intended, for this next movie, like the milk in regards to evil in Clockwork Orange.
There was me, that is Alex, and my three droogs, that is Pete, Georgie, and Dim. And we sat in the Corova milk bar, trying to make up our razoo dogs what to do with the evening. The Corova milk bar sold Milk Plus Velocet, or Synthomesk, or Drencrum, which is what we were drinking. This would sharpen you up and make you ready for a bit of the old ultraviolence.
Maxilum, no, unfortunately, there is no Toronto film on my list. I should have thought of that, though. Oh, like, I should have consulted with you first. But yeah, I'm Silver Polish. Things don't just happen for coincidence. It's so true. But yeah, so in that scene of Clockwork Orange, for those of you who aren't familiar, it's all about how society has been stripped of its individualism and the sheer cruelty and horrors that that these characters go on to commit. And so it's very interesting how they relate that before they go off to commit all these heinous crimes, they first go to the milk bar. Now, granted, the milk bar is a very scandalous looking place, but it's so telling because it right there, it makes us think, okay, they're there drinking glasses of milk. And it reminds us that, you know, these characters, they're not old. They're actually supposed to be portrayed as very young. And it's so interesting to be in a milk bar, milk that is the most human, the most, like you know what I mean? It is the most bodily element that we could drink. And for them to be there in a bar that is dedicated to milk, in a society that has been completely stripped of its humanity and its individualism, is so strange. And it's and the parallels and the paradoxes between the two is extremely foreboding. Extremely foreboding. But yeah, this is the, like, for the last movie clip that we're going to be seeing for this stream is this scene from Inglourious Basterds. Now, this scene specifically won the actor, let's see, I can't remember what award he won, but he won, like, a really important, Academy Award prize, and it was well-deserved, and of course his as a co-star, I should say, in this scene, is Milk.
Aware of the nickname the people of France have given me?
I have no interest in such things.
But you're aware of what they call me?
I'm aware.
What are you aware of?
They call you the Girondin.
Precisely. I understand your trepidation in repeating it. Heydrich apparently hates the moniker the good people of Prague have bestowed on him. Actually, why he would hate the name the hangman's baffling to me. It would appear he's done everything in his power to earn it. I, on the other hand, love my unofficial title, precisely because I've earned it. The feature that makes me such an effective hunter of the Jews is, as opposed to most German soldiers, I can think like a Jew, where they can only think like a German. More precisely, a German soldier. Now, if one were to determine what attribute the German people share with a beast, it would be the cunning and the predatory instinct of a hawk. But if one were to determine what attributes the Jews share with the beast, it would be that of the rat. The Führer and Goebbels propaganda have said pretty much the same thing. But where our conclusions differ is I don't consider the comparison an insult. Consider for a moment the world a rat lives in. It's a hostile world indeed. If a rat were to scamper through your front door right now, would you greet it with hostility?
I suppose I would.
Has a rat ever done anything to you to create this animosity you feel toward him?
Rats spread diseases to bite people.
Rats were the cause of the bubonic plague, but that's some time ago. I propose to you any disease a rat could spread, a squirrel could equally carry. Would you agree?
Right.
Yet I assume you don't share the same animosity with squirrels that you do with rats, do you?
No.
Yet they're both rodents, are they not? And except for the tail, they even rather look alike, don't they?
It's an interesting thought, Herr Colonel.
However interesting as the thought may be, it makes not one bit of difference to how you feel. If a rat were to walk in here right now as I'm talking, would you greet it with a source of your delicious milk?
Probably not.
I didn't think so. You don't like them? You don't really know why you don't like them. All you know is you find them repulsive. Consequently, a German soldier conducts a search of a house suspected of hiding Jews. Where does the hawk look? He looks in the barn, he looks in the attic, he looks in a cellar, he looks everywhere he would hide. But there's so many places it wouldn't have occurred to a hawk to hide. However, the reason the Führer's brought me off my Alps in Austria and placed me in French cow country today is because it does occur to me. Because I'm aware what tremendous feats human beings are capable of once they abandon dignity. May I smoke my pipe as well?
Please, Herr Colonel, make yourself at home.
Now, my job dictates that I must have my men enter your home and conduct a thorough search before I can officially cross your family's name off my list. And if there are any irregularities to be found, rest assured they will be. That is unless you have something to tell me that makes the conducting of a search unnecessary. I might add also that any information that makes a performance of my duty easier will not be met with punishment. Actually, quite the contrary, it will be met with reward. And that reward will be your family will cease to be harassed in any way by the German military during the rest of our occupation of your country. You're sheltering enemies of the state, are you not?
Yes.
You're sheltering them underneath your floorboards, aren't you?
Yes.
Point out to me the areas where they're hiding.
Okay, well, yes, Meshgrab, I couldn't let the last movie clip, I couldn't let go the last, spoil what the last movie clip was going to be. Of course there was going to be a Tarantino, but I'm really happy you all approve of my movie choices. I like to think I have good taste in films, but yes, I'm happy it's approved. That scene to so many layers. So well done. My gosh. I'm like, oh, Bus Baby Steel. Oh, you're so sweet to me. it's really interesting because, granted, this is the most iconic scene that has Nazism and milk in it. But really, there, if you look closely, there are actually tons of movies that are about the Nazis, and somewhere or other there's always a reference to milk. There's always the milk being used as a prop in some sort. There's a lot of them. And I think it has to tell with one, during the period of the time, which is, you know, there are times of war. Who had a cow during those times? I'm pretty sure they probably blew up all the cows by accident. You know, so the idea of being able to have milk was like the Egyptians, it was a delicacy of sorts. And in this case as well, in terms of symbolism, the milk is being used as a guise. It's just like, no, I'm actually a very good person. I'm a very good person. You see, I don't drink, I drink milk. Like, if I drink anything, it's milk. I'm a good human being, you know? So I think that is a very interesting trope that they use in regards to the Nazis is milk. That was a powerful movie, so much so, right, Boss Baby Steel? I need to learn to be quiet. Like, why? So sorry, I almost ruined it. No, not at all. Not at all. You didn't ruin anything. I love it. I was like, oh, Maxillum knows his stuff. Max Lemon knows his stuff. I loved it. No, don't worry. You don't spoil anything. No, don't you worry a bit. But I like teasing all of you. I like teasing all of you. But yeah, so we cannot end this stream talking about the Nazis, you know? So we need to end on something a little bit more lighthearted and something a little more current. This isn't exactly about milk. I'm going to be honest. This, what I'm about to show you, isn't really about milk. It was a campaign by a brand new cereal company. And they were, you know, they're just starting out. They needed something very low budget. They couldn't afford a lot, but they were able to do this. Now, as you can see, it's just a very simple campaign, text to image pieces. Let's see. Yes, we definitely could Hand of Malice. We definitely could. So what I loved about this campaign, that this actually just happened this week, as you can see by the text, they say Michael Jordan loves our cereal, asterisk, Serena Williams eats our cereal. But this company didn't have the budget to pay for Serena Williams, didn't have the budget to use Ronaldo's name and all these celebrities' names. What they did is they found actual people that had their names, like Dwayne Johnson. They found a person that had Serena Williams' name, Michael Jordan's name, those exact names, and used them in the campaign. But you can see they put a little asterisk and in very small font to make sure that they're not infringing on copyright rights with the person's name. They say, not the Serena Williams you're thinking of, not the Dwayne Johnson you might be thinking of. I thought it was such an incredibly smart campaign for what it was, very low budget and very effective. Because you first think, oh yeah, Michael Jordan likes it. And if you don't read the fine print, you're going to go off to buy, going to go on to buy the cereal with the milk and say, hey, like, I think this is, because it's endorsed by Serena Williams, it must be good. Right? Smash Cabin is very clever. Like, marketing is an art in itself. Absolutely, Boss Baby Steel. Absolutely. Okay. And also to end this stream, like, not to end the stream, but to end this class, I should say, just the class itself, because we're not going to end the stream just yet. Let's make a poll. Okay, new poll. Let's see, I want to know where everyone's allegiances lie. Let's see, we're going to do a poll here. Okay. All right, everyone, we need to, I'm going to put this on a 2-minute timer. All right, I need to know, is everyone down for milk and cereal, or what do you call it, milk and cookies? Which reigns supreme? Milk and cereal or milk and cookies? I know it's a terrible, terrible decision to make, but you imagine if you had to pick a team, which side of the war you have to be on. Let's talk about milk and Nazis. Which one would you pledge your allegiance to? I think I know what I'll pledge mine to, but I need to, I'm curious to see what everyone else's reactions are, because, you know, cereal without milk is not as pleasant. I mean, you can eat a cookie without milk, granted, it's very plausible. But it's not as easy with cereal. So that's where my theology is going. But I want to see if anyone can change my mind. Can anyone change my mind on this one? Let's see. But yes, I do, Boss Baby Still, you know me too well. I do love my cereal every day. 6:30 a.m. If I am not holding a bowl of cereal in my hands, there's something very wrong. Oh, let's see. Oh, Real Sportsman. Oh, Fisherman's Donuts is going to love that. I thank you, Real Sportsman. You're so sweet. Real Sportsman, where do your allegiances lie? Milk and cookies or milk and cereal? Not to put you on the spot or anything. Cookies are, yeah, it's true, Maxilim. Cookies are so good with milk. So good. Oh, and just cookies alone are just so good. Mm. Oh, and Tim Maxilim as well. Aw, that's so sweet. You can eat a bagel for breakfast or toast and jam or oatmeal or yogurt. That's true. Let's see, milk and cookies. Oh, milk and cookies won by 60%. Very interesting. I like. Oh gosh, the cookies laugh out loud. Okay, there was force and size with the cookies. Don't worry. Honestly, there's no right or wrong answer. I love you all just the same, but your quail is gonna have to side with milk and cereal. Because I can't have cereal without my milk. Mm-mm, now that we're gonna have some problems. Why choose to have cookies? They have cookie crisp cereal with milk. Ooh, I like that. Okay, best of both worlds. Leave it to Smash Grab to come up with the solution. So it's a tie. Oh wait, was it a tie? Oh, so maybe it's a tie. Hard to say. Oh well, let's just leave it as a tie then. Let's see, my grandfather used to pour milk over cornbread for breakfast. Hmm. Maybe your grandfather was onto something, Maxilim. Maybe he was onto something. Maybe he knows something we don't. Let's see, but everyone, I hope you enjoyed this milky stream. I know I enjoyed it to the fullest. So thank you for seeing through that. That was a really fun piece to do. Whoever wants to have a special theme or feature in the next stream, please be sure to put it in the Discord suggestions channel.